Participating in this webinar. This term hydrogen is quite a new term basically. We have heard of hydrogen and secondly I just wanted to know whether what you know about hydrogen, what is your knowledge about hydrogen so far, because now it is the term being used globally for energy. And so please let me know what is your take on hydrogen so far. So you can take 1 minute so that I understand your understanding, the understanding of the audience regarding hydrogen as a fuel, even hydrogen in day-to-day life. So very nice, Lord. I appreciate your efforts in communicating back. It shows you are all alert, agile. So good. Lot of teachers are from mechanical engineering in this webinar. So we can deal something little in detail about the aspects of engine also when it comes to hydrogen as a fuel. So the outline, thank you all for your responses, appreciate that. The outline of the presentation will be something like this. We'll have a small introduction about hydrogen. Then we'll see IEA, that is the International Energy Agencies. They have given some recommendations about to scale up hydrogen. That we'll see. Then we'll also see the production of hydrogen since 1975, globally how it is moving ahead, surging ahead. Physical properties of hydrogen, hydrogen supply and demand, current scenario, and what are the methods of producing hydrogen, what are the costs, like now they talk actually globally is on green hydrogen. Hydrogen is currently being produced in large numbers, but it is only for oil refining and fertilizer manufacturing, but now we are planning for green hydrogen for transport as well as power sector. So what are the benefits? We will see that applications, and finally we will see the application of hydrogen in IC engines. So can you tell me which is this car? Very recently this is in news, very popular. I can give a hint, it is from Japan. This car you can Google also. So this is running on hydrogen. So a massive effort has been done, good. A massive effort has been done by the manufacturers, because now as even Hirkoti sir was telling, I was listening to him very carefully. Though the governments have got policies, regarding implementation is a big issue. Moreover, if it is not economically very lucrative, then people don't stick on to that. Like biodiesel, he was telling 20% in the 1999 they have come, and 2018 again they have come out with one more policy to blend 20% biodiesel in diesel, but so far it is not done, only hardly 0.1% something, and even ethanol only 2% practically as against 20% envisaged long back. So this is Toyota Yaris, we'll discuss about this further. Yeah. ICE means IC engines basically. H2 stands for hydrogen here. So we will look at the combustion properties of hydrogen. Also we will look at the problems when you are using hydrogen in an IC engine, basically a petrol engine. What are the difficulties you come across? What is the thermal efficiency, power output as well as emissions? So this introduction about hydrogen, as you all know, everybody is now talking about decarbonization. I think Dr. Borkar also this morning, he was talking about green fuels and what is the impact of human activity on the environment. I think I appreciate his concern. We as sensible citizens, we have to take care of not only our generation but for generations to come. So over these years, a man started with coal, and as Dr. Kamath was referring in his keynote address, we started with coal, and today we ended up with electrical vehicles. But this even electrical vehicles, they run on electricity and it is produced predominantly by coal. Even 60% of power generated today, as on date as we speak, it is from coal. So it is very necessary that we decarbonize the sectors, especially long haul transport, chemicals, iron and steel manufacturing. So we are in a very critical situation today. As Hirkade sir was telling, I think if you have heard our Honorable Prime Minister speak in the Independence Day, he spoke that India almost imports 12 lakh crores worth of crude oil annually. That is our huge crude oil bill. And that we pay through foreign exchange. So today, though India is a politically independent nation, but energy wise it is not an independent nation, it is a dependent nation. And we depend on Middle East and other countries for supply of crude oil. And you may also appreciate that the reserves, whatever India has, the storage capacity especially, is very minimal, hardly for a month or so. So we have challenges, and as a nation we have decided that instead of being a net importer of fuel for energy requirements, we'll try to produce hydrogen and try to export and be a net exporter of fuels rather than be a net exporter as on 2021. So there are a lot of you have heard of COP26, the other day it has taken place. India has committed that we are going to reduce the emissions, and by 2030 we are reducing, and by 2070 will be net, as a nation will be net zero emitter. The other aspect of it is around 3 million, that is 30 lakh people are dying prematurely due to pollution. It's a silent killer basically. So it has impact on environment, it is killing people, it is draining our foreign exchange. So the need for alternate fuels, and Professor Hirkade I think rightly has chosen this topic of alternate fuels, because this is a high time the country thinks of alternate fuels rather than relying on the conventional source of fuels. Luckily today technologies are available to produce hydrogen. Though it is expensive, it is available. It is technically feasible, maybe economically not viable as on date, but it is technically feasible. So we have technologies to store and move it. Production technologies, storage technology, as well as transport technologies are available. And if you look at fuels like renewables, like it can be solar, wind, even a small hydro. So they have some problems with storage. So hydrogen can be used for storage, that we'll discuss. And this hydrogen can be transported in the gas pipelines, or you can liquefy it, as sir was telling, at minus 252 degrees centigrade. You can liquefy hydrogen and it can be transported as LNG, liquefied natural gas. It can be transformed into electricity by combustion, and it can power homes and feed industries and as well as transport. So today India has aggressively gone for renewables, be it solar and wind, and today I think we are in the top 5 nations globally producing electricity through renewable route. We have almost 350 gigawatt of generating capacity, and a large chunk is now coming through the renewables. But the problem with renewables is sunlight is there for only a limited period of time, so 6 to 8 hours in a day. And wind also you don't get all the 24 hours a day. So, but the demand of electricity is there throughout the day. So the demand and supply is not matched well. And that is where now we are, the nation and globally, the countries are looking for hydrogen for storing this energy from renewables. I think you might have heard of pumped hydro storage, pumped storage for hydel power plants. Similarly, we are planning to produce hydrogen from the electricity which we have surplus, either from a nuclear power plant or from the renewables, and store it. And you can store it for days, weeks, or even months. And hydrogen and hydrogen-based fuels can be used for transport. That is, as it was discussed, lot of a majority of the oil which is imported goes for transport sector. As on today, hydrogen is mainly used for oil refining as well as production of fertilizers. But the world is now looking out for options so that hydrogen can be used for transport, buildings, as well as power generation. So the three main sectors, like transport sector, building, and power generation, the world is looking for. I think you might have heard even the corporate giants of India, like you know that Adani, Ambani, and all. They are now they are going to invest almost 50,000 to 75,000 crores of rupees over the next one decade to produce hydrogen, and they have promised that after one decade, hydrogen will be costing somewhere around $1 per kg in one decade. So this is one challenge what they have taken, and I hope with the aggressive involvement of private sector in India, we will definitely be there. And by another one decade, we will not be importer, but we will be next net exporter of fuel in the form of hydrogen. So what are the challenges currently? So currently it is very costly at the moment. Costly in the sense, petrol or diesel today costs about 100 rupees a litre, whereas there's a hydrogen will cost around 300 rupees. So it is not economically viable for using it in transport sector. But I think you might have seen this Dalda and all hydrogenated oil. Hydrogen is used for solidification of oil, which is used as a good preservative for food products. That is there. And the cost, this solar, if you look at solar for that matter, earlier the cost of solar energy was very high. Even the electricity produced was costing somewhere around 10 rupees per kilowatt hour per unit. But today it has fallen down. Now it is hovering somewhere less than 3 rupees per unit. So when the prices have fallen down by almost 300 times, 3x, then it is high time that we make use of the electricity, especially from renewable sources, so that we can scale up the hydrogen production. Okay. Even as it was discussed, fuel cells is a very promising technology. Hydrogen can be either directly used as a fuel, or it can be used as a fuel in a fuel cell vehicle, what we call it FCEV, fuel cell electrical vehicle, and that can be used for transport. I have seen one fuel cell electrical vehicle in an exhibition at Bangalore International Exhibition Center, where BHEL, Bharat Heavy Electrical Limited of Bhopal, they had manufactured a fuel cell, and they are running a big bus using fuel cell. So the day is not far away, maybe another one decade you will find, as you find electrical EV, electrical vehicles and electrical buses flying now, you will find fuel cell vehicles also in the near future. The one more challenge is there is no infrastructure. Like electrical vehicles, you lack infrastructure for charging. Electrical, you don't have charging points at very convenient locations. And moreover, the charging duration is very long for electrical vehicles. So they are trying to curtail that. Similarly, here also the hydrogen infrastructure has to be set up. Like you need to be having that ways to store and transport hydrogen. This is a global issue, and it is being tackled globally, not only in India, in Europe, US, worldwide. I think Australia, everywhere they are. The countries have committed to change to hydrogen as a fuel of future. So today hydrogen is being made out of natural gas and coal. So again, natural gas and coal means they are hydrocarbons only. So you have CO2 emissions. So because of this, you have CO2 emissions, and we are basically trying to decarbonize, means reduce the CO2 emissions. So plans are there for capture of CO2 and usage of CO2 in other forms. So government and industry are working together to ensure the existing regulations are not a barrier to the investment. As I have told, the corporate giants are now pitching in, and if it becomes the technology is very viable, then definitely India is a land of entrepreneurs, and we will see that lot of smaller tier 2 companies also will get in. Not only this, even L&T is there into this. L&T is into hydrogen now. GAIL, Gas Authority of India Limited, is into hydrogen manufacturing. So lot of companies are there, like globally Cummins is a big industry which is looking into manufacture of hydrogen by using the electrolyzers. Even the trade will benefit, and now plans are there for the storing the large volume of hydrogen. So basically, International Energy Agency (IEA) they have come at some recommendations which are like having far reaching implications. So basically, that is the idea, is to promote hydrogen, make it accessible, make it affordable, make it available, so that a common man can use in days to come. So accordingly, most of the nations have gone by this, and now they are having their own goals, and they have own their priorities to encourage the industries. Secondly, stimulate commercial demand for clean hydrogen. And third is address investment risk of first movers, because the people who are moving in first, now I told, with corporates are there, even L&T, GAIL, and all. They may see this is a risky proposition, so there may be losses. So government has to pitch in. Then R&D, basically a lot of research and development has to happen to lower the cost and improve the performance. Especially the fuel cells. Fuel cells, I think, past 2-3 decades, a lot of research is going on. And as far as hydrogen is concerned, electrolyzers, that is, hydrogen, when we talk of electrolysis, means converting this water, breaking of water into hydrogen and oxygen, and both can be used. Then a lot of barriers, basically, hydrogen being a fuel and very highly inflammable, a lot of barriers are there. So these hurdles has to be removed by the government, new regulations. And now internationally, see, it's not that one country, now we have to engage internationally and track the progress, because now we should be able to trade hydrogen and transport hydrogen as we are doing it for the crude oil presently. We should be able to trade globally. And we should also focus on the opportunities to increase the momentum for the next decade. So these are recently, I think I got downloaded very recently. So the world is looking for the shipping routes to kickstart the international hydrogen trade. So these are the seven guidelines given by International Energy Agency so as to promote hydrogen globally. Now if you look at this picture, this annual demand of hydrogen since 1975, you can see there are three colors only, right from 75 to 2018 it is. This red color indicates oil is used for, this hydrogen is for oil refining. Yellow color is for ammonia, which is goes into this fertilizer production, and then balance is very little. So almost 70 million tons of hydrogen per year is used in pure form, mostly for oil refining and ammonia manufacture, that is for fertilizer. And around 4.5 million tons of hydrogen is used for industry. So let us look into the details of hydrogen as a fuel. So a lot of parameters are given here, and it's compared actually with the right third column. You can see it is compared. So density as such, it is very very light. You can see 0.089 kg per meter cube. Even air, if you look at air is having 1.2 or 1.3 kg per meter cube depending on the temperature. So here for 0 degree and 1 bar pressure, the density is very low. So that is the main problem of hydrogen. And I think you know that we used to use childhood, we used to use hydrogen for balloons basically. So it is almost 1/10 of the natural gas. Density also as a liquid, when you liquefy it at minus 253 degrees centigrade, it is 70 kg per meter cube. So even when it is in a liquid form, if you take water, water is almost 1000 kg per meter cube, but this is only 70 kg per meter cube. So density is also very low compared to water, or 1/16 of a natural gas here. Boiling point is minus 253 degrees centigrade at 1 bar. This is 90 degrees centigrade below LNG. The energy per unit mass, this is the plus point of hydrogen. Here you can see per kg, hydrogen gives 120 megajoules of energy, which is 3 times that of petrol. 1 liter of petrol will give somewhere, 1 kg of petrol will give 44 megajoules of energy, whereas hydrogen is 3 times more powerful per unit mass. And flame velocity, if you look at flame velocity, it is almost 8 times of methane, 5 to 6 times of petrol. So the fire catches very fast, and flame velocity is very fast, 345 centimeters per second. And one more advantage is the range of ignition. Actually, hydrogen has got a wide range of ignition, right from 4% to 77% in air by volume. So it can catch fire at 4% or even 77%. So very lean and very rich mixture also. And it's got almost 6 times wider than methane. So very wide ignition range we are having. This is also one plus point of hydrogen. And auto ignition temperature is almost 500 plus 585 degrees centigrade, whereas it is 220 degrees centigrade for petrol. So hydrogen as an element, chemical symbol is H and atomic number is 1. So it is the most abundant chemical substance in the universe, constituting almost 75% of the normal matter. Okay, it has one proton, one electron and no neutrons. So now I will compare, this slide will compare hydrogen with other fuels. So you can see here, we have got four fuels like natural gas, petroleum, diesel, as well as LPG. So if you look at calorific value per kg, megajoules per kg, you can see hydrogen has highest, that is 120 to 140, there is a range basically, megajoules of energy per kg of fuel, whereas petrol, as I said earlier, 41 to 44, and LPG is 46 to 50 megajoules. So in per kg, it has got the highest energy density. But what about the density at standard conditions? You can see kgs per cubic meter. You can see it is about only 0.08. In one cubic meter, you will have only 0.08 of kgs. Whereas natural gas is 0.6. Petrol is almost, the specific gravity is 720 to 780 kg per cubic meter. So even the auto ignition temperature of hydrogen is almost 580 degrees centigrade, whereas petrol it is almost half of that, 250 degrees centigrade. And diffusion also, the diffusion coefficient is very high of hydrogen, 0.61 when compared to 0.05 of petroleum. So combustion, if you look at combustion routes, as I was telling, there are two routes, one is combustion and second is using in a fuel cell vehicle. So combustion routes, H2 plus O2 just gives you water. So the tailpipe emissions will be normally only water. But because the combustion occurs at a high elevated temperature, you will have NOx formation also. So if you look at the supply and demand, that top half is the supply, means how hydrogen is made. And bottom demand means how, where it can be used. So you can see bottom, that red one is transport. In the transport bottom half, now I am talking about the bottom half. Here you can see the transport is in red. There are IC engines, conventional IC engines. And then you have got fuel cell engines, FC engines. Then it can be used in commercial transport. Then buildings. this all fuel cell technology only. When you saw blue color the band, you can see the fuel cell. So it can be engine, it fuel cell can be used for powering the buildings, okay, as well as power generation. And it can be also used in process synthesis and turbines in the industry. Whereas production, hydrogen can be produced using coal, natural gas, biomass, solar thermal energy. These are all renewable. Green color is all renewable. Solar, photovoltaics, small hydro, wind, and the process used is electrolysis. The process used is electrolysis, and the equipment what is used is known as electrolyzer. And nuclear also energy can be used. Like we are from Karwar. Here we have got a Kaiga nuclear power plant with almost 840 megawatt. And they are going for a second phase of expansion with another, I think, 1200 megawatt. So in case they have got surplus electricity, that electricity can be used for generation of production of power. Production of hydrogen using water in a electrolyzer. I think this slide is not visible clearly. Then we will go through the current methods of producing hydrogen. So steam methane reformation, partial oxidation, autothermal reforming, methanol reforming, pyrolysis, oxidation and reduction of biomass, electrolysis of water, fermentation of organic materials, and thermal chemical splitting of water. But we look at the value chains. If you look at the value chain today, you can see this graph. It is natural gas, the highest contributor, then coal, oil and electricity very low. So you can see left side, if you see left side, you will see that natural gas and coal are the highest. Oil and electricity are very low because it becomes very expensive if you use electricity or oil to produce hydrogen. Okay. And the right side you can see this yellow color, red and yellow, this is our usage. Usage is in refining, ammonia production, very little in transport, and then production of methanol. So this is the present production as well as usage of hydrogen. This is a global scenario from IEA. I think I downloaded this. One important aspect, actually, what the world is looking at is this graph, basically. With the cost of solar electricity, electricity produced from solar photovoltaic going down, and countries like India, you can see here, China, Africa, Australia, even South America, parts of Africa, even Middle East, you can see the cost of producing 1 kg of hydrogen in the red colored this is less than $1.6. Means that is almost 120 rupees. In a long term, this is a long term scenario, again by IEA. These countries which are rich, God has bestowed a lot of sunlight on these countries over like a larger period of time, maybe 300 plus days in a year annually. So these countries, they can harness the solar energy and produce hydrogen at a very competitive price. This is what the world is now looking at. As you told, Australia, Africa, South America, US, Middle East. Now they are all planning, China, they are all planning for production of hydrogen because using solar photovoltaics, because it is very economical. You can see in days to come, maybe in less than a decade, I am optimistic that in less than a decade you will find hydrogen being sold at 100, and that will be an alternate fuel for the conventional engines only. Whereas the regions in the North Pole and where the colder regions are there, they are not having that sunshine. So the cost will be higher.